Hello and welcome to Rise of the Data Cloud. Today's episode features an interview with Warren Breakstone, Managing Director and Chief Product Officer at S&P Global's Market Intelligence Division. Warren has previously served as head of the Capital Markets Unit and held senior leadership roles at Thomson Reuters and its predecessor organization, the Thomson Corporation, and at the Chase Manhattan Bank. On this episode, Warren talks about the versatility of movement data, the role S&P's data plays in informing COVID-19 decisions, the future of financial services, and much more. So please enjoy this conversation between Warren Breakstone, Managing Director and Chief Product Officer at S&P Global, and your host, Steve Hamm.
Hi, Steve. Nice to meet you.
Hey, nice to meet you, Warren. Now, you've been in the data technology and the financial service business for quite a few years, now at S&P Global, earlier at Thomson and at Chase Manhattan before it became JP Morgan. How have you seen this market segment change over the years? What are the big business trends and business drivers?
Well, I've been very fortunate to work in the financial services industry for about 25 years. There's been tremendous change over that time, which is very much tied to the evolution in technology. I remember early on when we would be out speaking with clients about a new data set or solution, and they'd consider it, but only if it really replaced something else that they were relying on, as they didn't really have the capacity to take on something new. They didn't have the storage capacity, the processing power capacity, particularly if it was a desktop application, and they really didn't have the time. Just to give you a sense about how much has changed, back in the early 1990s, a terabyte of storage could cost you tens of millions of dollars. Today, you can get a terabyte of storage on iCloud for about $10 a month and half that on many of the other cloud providers. Mm-hmm. A gigahertz of processing power back then might cost you the equivalent of a small house in San Mateo. Today, it's the equivalent of a cup of Pete's coffee. And you don't even need to buy the processing power anymore. You can rent it from Snowflake or any of the other cloud providers. So storage is no longer an issue. Processing power is quite plentiful. And now our clients are taking advantage of the technology innovations that these advances have allowed for, whether it be incorporating machines or big data analytics, AI, new research and techniques. And at the same time, and probably to a large degree because of it, there's also been this explosion of new data, a lot of it termed alternative data, really allowing clients the raw materials to fuel these processes and tools. It's certainly really been quite the journey.
I wanted to talk a little bit about the history of S&P, because I think, you know, there's been so many changes over the past decade. S&P Global is the name of the company now. It was formerly called McGraw-Hill Companies. It's divested the trade book publishing, textbook, TV stations, a bunch of other businesses, and focusing on information services for the financial services industry, which was a core piece of the business. So it'd be helpful if you would describe kind of the main businesses that S&P has now.
Right. And there has been a lot of change, both in the company, but also in the markets we serve and our client needs. Yeah. And I like to think that as those client needs have evolved, so has S&P Global. Yeah. Under the leadership of our CEO, Doug Peterson, we've really transformed the business to focus on delivering what we term essential intelligence through must-have data and solutions to help our clients make decisions and be able to make those decisions with confidence and conviction. We're organized today around four divisions. Each division is a leader in their respective markets. First and our largest is S&P Global Ratings. It's the world-leading provider of credit rating and research that serve to drive transparency in the capital markets. Next is S&P Dow Jones Indices. It's the largest global resource for index-based concepts, data, and research, and home to the S&P 500, which is the most tracked index in the world by assets under management. Platts is our third division. It's the leading independent provider of information and benchmark prices for the commodities and energy markets. And then lastly, we have our S&P Global Market Intelligence, which provides data, research, and technology, along with analytical capabilities that enable our clients to make business and investment decisions. And the data and the analytics are delivered through our desktop solutions, Express Feed, which is our bulk data feed delivery, APIs, and now cloud delivery, including from Snowflake. Additionally, back in 2018, we purchased Kensho, which is a leader in machine learning and applied data science. And we now have those capabilities and talent from Kensho supporting all four of the divisions to help us build and enhance content and products, automate and scale processes, and also to benefit from the Kensho data scientists.
Warren, you've done a great job of describing the company's business, but it'd be really helpful to understand how you fit in. What's your role there?
Thank you for asking. So I work in the market intelligence division, and I'm responsible for our data management solutions, Truecost, which is our climate and ESG franchise, and QSIP, which is our identifier business, which we operate on behalf of our partners at the American Banker Association. On the data management solution side, we are very much focused on data innovation and delivering that data to our clients through feeds and APIs and cloud-based distribution, and then help our clients to layer on their own analytics and tools and machines on top of it.
And are all of your customers within financial services, or do you kind of cut beyond that?
Actually, we cut quite beyond that. Our clients range from large investment managers and pension funds to investment banks, commercial banks, insurance firms, and corporates and academics. Mm-hmm. So one of the benefits of S&P Global is really the diversity of our client base.
Mm-hmm. Now, let's talk about some broad trends in terms of data. What are you hearing from your clients in terms of how they want to interact with your data? Things changing there?
Very much so. Good question. Our clients are increasingly interested in being able to bring data directly into their environments, into their systems, into their databases, their data warehouses, tools, and then layer on their own proprietary analytics, data science tools and approaches to help them make better decisions, whether it be an investment decision or a business decision. And while this is not a new trend, it is certainly one that's gaining increased importance across all the segments in which we operate, from investment management and banks, insurance firms, corporations. They're all looking to unlock data and technology to their advantage. And at the same time, our clients are also overwhelmed with data, their own data, traditional data, alternative data, derivative data, economic data, satellite data, you name it. And they have to spend a lot of time and effort to ingest that data, to structure it, clean it, database it. All of that time would be better spent on the analysis itself. By one report, 90% of the world's data has been created in just the past 2 years, and it's not slowing down. So this is an area where we really very much look to help.
You talked about alternative data. I mean, in a sense, you know, it used to be a lot of the analysis of data was done was very narrow. But now with this alternative data, it's really all sorts of contextual and kind of understanding whole systems and how they interact with other systems, right? Or what's going on there?
Well, I think when you strip away the marketing, alternative data is at its core data. It's data that was perhaps originally designed for one use case and is now being used for a different use case for which it was really never intended. Now, that data is often poorly structured. It could lack history, may have some gaps, very difficult to ingest. And that's where a provider like S&P Global really adds its value. What we're seeing is that as clients really start to rely on this alternative data, their expectations have begun to converge with those expectations that they have already for the traditional data that they already utilize. Whether the data is alternative or the data is traditional, clients ultimately need confidence. Right. They need confidence that the data will be comprehensive, it'll be accurate without gaps, that it'll be consistently structured for their analysis. It often needs to be complemented with other content to extract full value. And if there's a problem, they have someone to call to fix it. So my sense is that the label alternative data will likely soon disappear, and it'll all just be referred to as data.
Yeah, that's really interesting. You know, Frank Slootman, the CEO of Snowflake, You know, he talks about big data because people have been talking about that for years. And he says, we don't even use that term. It's all just data, every which kind. And you've got to be able to deal with it all. You've got to be able to integrate it all. So it's some of these distinctions that were so important in the past really have kind of faded out as things have become more mainstream. And I guess more as technologies and thinking has been more matured in the business. Yeah. Now, I know that one of the key pieces of S&P Global is the market intelligence division, which I believe you came up in. And it seems like a lot of your innovation is happening in that area. If you could kind of talk about, you know, the growth in that business, the competitive landscape, the innovative landscape, I think that would be really helpful.
Well, Steve, there's a lot of innovation happening across the entire S&P Global organization. In market intelligence, it really starts with the data. We aspire to offer the highest quality, most comprehensive and relevant content to help our clients make decisions. Data is accurate with deep history, some of it going back as far to the 1950s, and structured in a way that allows clients to get maximum use from it. And then we're able to deliver that data to our clients, the way that they desire, whether it be a desktop solution such as our market intelligence platform or our Capital IQ desktop, Express Feed, which is our data feed solution, APIs, cloud-hosted delivery. But it all really starts with the content. We pride ourselves on high-quality, comprehensive data. And as far as I know, we're the only provider who supports that pledge with a quality program, where if a client finds an error in our traditional data sets, reports it, we'll do a root cause analysis, we'll fix it at the core, we'll check for other errors like it, and reward the client with a $50 contribution to their charity of choice or an Amex gift card. So it really is putting our money behind our pledge.
Yeah, as long as you don't have too many of these, you're fine, right?
Very true. But we're happy to pay it out because even though we have skilled analysts and sophisticated tools and thousands of quality checks, when you're dealing with as much data as we do, sometimes an error does get through. And in those cases, we've paid out a fair share. And many of our clients, some are interns, have earned some meaningful spending money. Yeah. But every cent we pay out, it frankly is an investment. Along with our systemic and manual quality checks, it plays a role. Yeah.
And it also sends a signal to your own people how important quality is. It's kind of part of a culture of quality, I guess.
Very much so. We use it internally to help shape our culture, frankly, focus on quality across everything we do. In fact, we measure, we report, we remunerate everyone in our organization against content quality scores. Mm-hmm. And we found that to be an important sort of unifying purpose and principle.
Now, in the spring of 2020, you launched the S&P Global Marketplace. And it seems like this is a pretty significant new product launch. What's new and different about this, and why is it a big deal for your customers and also for S&P Global?
Well, it's a big deal for our customers, and it's a big deal for S&P Global. It was a very important milestone for our organization. The S&P Global Marketplace is a platform that helps clients to explore, discover, assess data from across all four divisions of S&P Global, along with select third-party alternative data, which we carefully curated, and for the first time includes solutions from Kensho and others that allow our clients to even get more out of the data that they already use. So all the data is linked to ensure quick client adoption and supported by our own proprietary quantamental research, enhanced with data visualization, data dictionaries, access to code snippet libraries, and much more, all on the same marketplace platform. And all the data on the platform can be sampled on the spot and also delivered through our Express Feed, FTPs, APIs, and now our cloud distribution. Response has been fantastic, and we have a long pipeline of exciting content and capability enhancements to come.
So one of the things this does, it seems like, is exposes the whole array of your customers, all the segments, to the whole array of your data for the first time. Is that correct?
That's correct. And it's not just our data. It's our data, it's select alternative data, and now solutions that will help those clients even get more out of the data and their own data for that matter.
Yeah. Yeah. Hey, crazy question, but is there some really very interesting and unusual data sets that you have within S&P Global Marketplace that people might be surprised to hear about?
Well, as far as interesting categories of data that we offer on the marketplace, we offer nearly 100 different data packages today, from our well-regarded CompuStat fundamental data to Platts commodity pricing, QSIP, along with SNL asset-related level data, and of course, S&P ratings. We're also investing heavily in some new categories. The top three categories of interesting new data now available includes ESG, where clients are increasingly looking to incorporate climate analytics into their decision processes. We offer the full gamut of data from Trucost, as well as from our S&P ESG scores, physical and transition risk. The second category is textual data. I think nearly 80% of the world's data today is unstructured. So we're going through the effort to help structure that content to be machine readable. Today, we offer machine readable earnings call transcripts for something like 14,000 companies. Right. And we recently introduced with our partner, Social Market Analytics, our machine readable filings as well. We also offer our suite of textual data analytics, which include 39 different sentiment and behavioral scores on top of our earnings transcripts. And with a newly announced partnership, we also offer unique Asia-specific earnings call transcripts from Scripps Asia. Mm-hmm. In the coming months, we're going to be extending textual data to include court cases, patent data, and credit research as well. I think probably the third category, which we're most interested in, is what we term movement data. People movement, goods, and money. We just added a foot traffic a set of data from AirSage, which helps us track people movements, which we then overlay on top of our REIT property database to help inform on the health and vitality of a physical location. You know, we know what happens when a Toys R Us goes under, but what happens to the store next door? Right. What happens when a Starbucks opens in a neighborhood? And we're already today a preeminent provider of supply chain data under the brand Panjiva, which now is further enhanced with our ESG data from Trucost to understand the impact of climate and distribution risk. We can go on and on. It's like being a kid in a candy shop.